You are listening to a sermon by Pastor Christopher Sally of New Life Christian Fellowship Church.
How to live your best life. Amen. You may have your seats. I'm living my best life. Smile, bruh. Smile, bruh. I'm living my best life. I ain't going back and forth with you brothers. Amen. I'm living my best life. Come on, somebody. If you know, you know. If you don't, you don't. Amen. But I can tell you that's exactly what Joseph eventually had to tell his brothers when he finally met up with them. He's like, don't worry about it, bro. I'm living my best life. And I ain't going back and forth with you brothers. So just go on ahead and smile. Amen. Let's look at Joseph's life again. We talked about Joseph walking with favor, and we talked about that a few weeks ago, and then we really talked in these last couple of weeks about the disciplines that Joseph had to have, that discipline of suffering, that the discipline of self-control, and we talked about and the discipline of stewardship, because we know that prosperity will test you. Amen. Pleasure will tempt you, and pain will try you. And so Joseph in Joseph 39 was at Potiphar's house, and when the pleasure tempted him, he did not yield it, but he ended up in prison anyway. Sometimes you can do the right thing and still end up in a situation where you are questioning how you got there and how you're going to get out of that. So Joseph was in prison, but as the scripture says in verse 20 of Genesis 39, but while Joseph was there in prison, the Lord was what? With him. He showed him kindness and granted him favor in the eyes of the prison warden. So even in a place of pain where Joseph was, the Lord was still with him. That really is what you want. It matters less about where you are, and it matters more if God is with you. Amen. Because if God is with you, you're going to be just fine. Amen. And so Joseph is in prison. And it starts out in chapter 40. Sometime later, the cupbearer and the baker of the king of Egypt offended their master. They ended up in prison with Joseph, and they had been custody for some time. I'm in chapter 40, and we're going to have to take some big steps here, because I want to tell you five reasons why you are how to live your best life. Amen. And it has a lot more to do than just smiling. That's not how you live your best life. Amen. Amen. There's some things that we can learn from Joseph's life that can show us how we can literally live our best life like Joseph did. And one of the first things that you and I need to understand is the importance of perseverance in circumstances. Amen. You are not going to be in a place where you are going to have a victorious life, to have a best life, to have a great life, if you and I cannot understand the importance of having perseverance in circumstances. Because if you don't like your circumstances, just wait, they will change. If they're good, they can turn sideways. If they're bad, they can get worse. If they're worse, they can get better. The only thing that we know that is constant is change. Amen. And so if your circumstances, if you're in a great place in your life right now, I'm happy for you. Amen. But you may soon be not in Potiphar's house, but you may be in prison. You may not be in the place of your birth. You may find yourself in the pit, and you might go up and down in your life. And so therefore, understanding that, you better understand the importance of perseverance in circumstances. And that's what Joseph did. So Joseph didn't pout. Joseph was running Potiphar's house, and now he's in a place that's not Potiphar's. It's not plush. It's not good. He's not in charge of Potiphar's house in such a way where there's comfort and ease. Now he's in prison. But when you have the same employer, your job never changes. Amen. Who did Joseph work for? He worked for God, and whatever you do in word and in deed, do all to the glory of God. So Joseph was like, here's a new situation, here's a new circumstance, and just like I was you were with me in Potiphar's house, you're with me now. So my job is the same, to help out, to actually run and use my gifts and talents to help organize the prison like I organized Potiphar's house. You and I have to have acceptance. That's one of the things in terms of the importance of perseverance, acceptance of where you are. Do what you can while you are where you are. Amen. I remember us when our church first started, one of the things that we did, we're meeting on 77th in Indiana, and we had this kind of anticipation that we wouldn't be there long. And we were there for 3 years. But we didn't do as much as we should have done, amen, because we kept saying we're leaving soon. So why engage with the community? Why get involved? Why do that? Well, we corrected that when we went to Roseland Christian School. Literally, when we got to Roseland, we said, we're not going to make the same mistake again. We're going to get in and engage with the Roseland community as best we can, as if we're going to be here forever. And when we're gone, we're gone. And you know what? We did food giveaways and clothing, and we did a bunch of canvassing in the neighborhoods and did all of that. And guess what? We were literally only there for 8 months. And then we came here. But we learned a lesson. And that lesson is accept where you are. Do what you can while you are there. And then it's not only just acceptance. There's you have to have some endurance. Amen. It's where you need to go. Learn what you can while you're there. Amen. So you and I need to be open. Sometimes when circumstances change, we're so excited or look so forward to getting out of it that we don't ask the Lord, what are you trying to teach me while I'm here? Amen. I already told you, God's not big on social promotion. Amen. You're not passing the grade just because you've been there long enough. He wants you to learn the lessons that you need to learn so that you can actually pass and go on to the next level, if you will. And so God is very much interested in teaching us lessons. And sometimes he puts us in places and gives us circumstances that we might be in a place where we learn what he wants us to learn. Amen. And you're not going to have a change in circumstance until you learn a lesson you need to learn. Just ask Jonah. Jonah, belly of the whale, 3 days, 3 nights. But I can tell you this. Jonah made a prayer and a confession. He said, they that observe lying vanities forsake their own mercy. He said, I will pay what I will vow. Salvation is of the Lord. And when he made that confession, the scripture says the fish spit him out on dry land. He never learns that. He never says that. He never understands and comes to that understanding of what God wanted to teach him in that place. He might have been in there for weeks. Amen. But when he learned what he was supposed to learn, this fish spit him out on dry land. And God said in chapter 3, now go to Nineveh and preach just like I told you to do in chapter 1. Amen. We didn't even need these two chapters. We could have just gone to Nineveh. It should have been right at chapter 3, should have been it. But Jonah does what we do. He didn't do what he was supposed to do, and sometimes you end up in the fish. Amen. Just like sometimes with Joseph, you end up in the pit. Come on, somebody. Acceptance and endurance, but then there's that expectance that you have to have. When will you come out? You have to anticipate and be ready for your change. Amen. Because God's timing is always perfect. And so here you have him with the cupbearer and the baker. And when Joseph came to them the next morning, verse 6, he saw that they were dejected. So he asked Pharaoh's officials who were in custody, why are your faces so sad? We both had dreams, but there is no one to interpret them. Now, we know that dreaming dreams is in Joseph's wheelhouse. That's what Joseph does. He dreams dreams. Now we're getting ready to find out that God has given him not only the ability to dream dreams, but to interpret them as well. And look what he says with humility and sensibility and accountability. We've talked about that. He says, do not interpretations belong to God? Tell me your dreams, because I know God. Don't interpretations belong to him? The chief cupbearer said, yeah, I had a dream. There was some vine, some ripened in the grapes. Pharaoh's cup was in my hand. I took the grapes, squeezed them in Pharaoh's cup, and put them in his hand. This is what it means, Joseph said. The branches are 3 days. Within 3 days, Pharaoh will lift up your head and restore you to your position. And you will put the cup in Pharaoh's hand. But when all goes well with you, come on, somebody, remember me. and show me kindness. Mention me to Pharaoh and get me out of this prison. Amen. I've done my job. I just need you to remember, here's my card. Here's my card. It's right there. It said Joseph right on the card. You can call me. I'll be here. I'm going to be here right in prison. When you get out in 3 days, come on, somebody. Remember me. Remember this good feeling that you had right here? Remember me. Here's the thing about life, though, and here's the thing about ministry. You can't be motivated in ministry thinking that people are going to remember what you do. Amen. They won't remember. Many times your motivation, at all times your motivation has to be about doing the right thing, amen, and doing what God has called you to do. Because just like this cupbearer forgot all about Joseph, amen, 3 days later, he was grinding. He was like, I'm just glad to be back. And he forgot all about Joseph. There'd be many people, if your motivation for doing things for people is for them to give you things or to remember you or for your name to be ringing out, you're going to hurt yourself and you're going to get your feelings hurt because people don't remember. By and large, they do not. But God remembers, God sees, and God knows, and that better be enough for you, amen? That better be enough for you, otherwise you're going to get your feelings hurt. And so then the chief baker stepped up. He saw the interpretation of the dream. He got excited. I too had a dream. He told him his dream, and Joseph said, this is what it means. Within 3 days, not Pharaoh will lift up your head, Pharaoh will lift off your head. Dear God, that must have been so disappointing for him. He's going to lift off your head and hang you on a tree, and the birds will eat away your flesh. That's just socialize that amongst yourself. That's just rough, but that's what God told him. Now the third day was his birthday, and the baker's head flew off, and his head flew off, and the cupbearer was restored to his position. So again, you have to have some perseverance and circumstances, because verse 1 of 41 says, when 2 full years had passed, Pharaoh had a dream. Now God has revealed dream interpretation to Joseph, but he's still been in prison. He's now been in the prison for 2 years. The cupbearer did not remember him. But when Pharaoh has a dream, if your relationship is not right with God, if you've been having a 2-year pity party, you've been mad, you've been nasty, you've been stank with God, when God's timing comes, you will not be ready. And so Joseph had to understand that and do that. That's why the second thing, and really how to live your best life, is understand the importance of perseverance, because he had to endure. That was 2 years of wrongful imprisonment. Just as a complete sidebar, when they see us on Netflix, the story of the Central Park Five, it just triggered something just to think about wrongful imprisonment, or Khalif Browder, wrongful imprisonment. There's so many stories that we'll have where something goes sideways, and if you don't understand the importance of endurance, perseverance in circumstances, you can literally lose hope, because there's some situations in life that we can find ourselves in, particularly as people of color, that are not right, they're not fair, and we want to scream and we want to shout and we want to say Lord, make me want to holler where they do my life. And Joseph could have been hollering and having a pity party, but instead God's timing was perfect, because Joseph understood this second lesson, which is the importance of reliance on God. It's not just for perseverance in circumstances, it's the importance of reliance on God. When folks see you, they need to see the Spirit of God in you. Amen. And based upon their interaction with you, their conclusion should be similar to the conclusion that Pharaoh had in Genesis 41 and verse 38, when Pharaoh asked him, can we find anyone like this man, one in whom is the Spirit of God? So let me give you the story as you know it. Again, these large steps, I know you know the story. Pharaoh had a dream. And he had to dream about the fat cows, and then then the ugly gaunt cows, and the healthy heads of grain, and then the ones that that were scorched and by the east wind and had thin heads. And so again, it was seven heads and seven cows, and he had that contrast, and his mind was troubled around that. And he said Pharaoh told them his dream, but no one could interpret the dream for him. Verse 8:41. Then the chief cupbearer said to Pharaoh, today I am reminded of my shortcomings. He did give me a card. I had it here. Pharaoh was once angry with his servant. See, and he imprisoned me in the chief baker. See, that you don't want to go back to that. That's probably be careful, because he could throw you back in there. Each of us had a dream. This young Hebrew was there. He told us the dream, and I was restored, and the other man was hanged. So Pharaoh sent for Joseph. And Pharaoh said to Joseph in verse 15, I had a dream and no one can interpret it, but I have heard it said of you that when you hear a dream, you can interpret it. I cannot do it, but God will give Pharaoh the answer he desires. No, that's I got to chill when you nah, I can't do it. It's not me, but I can tell you what. Pharaoh will get an answer because it's the God that's in me. It's not me, but it's the God that's in me. And don't you know that if people can see the God in you, that you can prosper, just like Daniel prospered or Joseph prospered. We've even had discussions about that little mini sermon series I did sometime last year about prosperity in terms of how do you prosper and what does a prosperous man look like. A prosperous man is one that understands that your best life includes the importance of reliance on God. Amen. Your best life will include you understanding that you're not doing anything by yourself, that it's the God that is in you, who is in you. Amen. And he quickly told him the dream, and he said the dreams of Pharaoh are one and the same, and we read that into your hearing. He said, it's just like I said. And he says he did it in two forms so that the matter has been firmly decided by God, and God will do it soon. And I love verse 33, because Joseph knows he's got everybody's attention now. And he says, now, let Pharaoh look for a discerning and wise man and put him in charge of the land of Egypt. Let Pharaoh appoint commissioners over the land to take a fifth of the harvest of Egypt during the 7 years of abundance. Then they should collect all the food these good years that are coming and store up the grain under the authority of Pharaoh. This food should be held in a reserve for the country to be used during the 7 years of famine that will come upon Egypt, so the country may not be ruined by the famine. Ooh, we've pivoted to the third thing now. If you want to live your best life, amen. Your very best life is going to include you understanding the importance of performance by you. Amen. It's the importance of perseverance in circumstances. You've got to have that. You have to have some perseverance. You have to understand that life goes up and down. That's true. You have to understand you have to rely on God, but you also have to have the understanding that you have to perform. Come on, somebody, when it's your time. When you get a chance to step up, when it comes to you, when the spotlight is on you, it's time to step up and perform. It's not time to make excuses. Not only did Joseph interpret the dream and God gave him that, God also gave him a plan to save Egypt. He said, listen, we're going to take 20% of what we glean in the good years, the 7 years, and that will help us to ride out the seven bad years. We need to put a plan in place. And just like a good steward from Luke 16, he looked ahead, he planned ahead, and Joseph moved ahead. Amen. And they implemented that plan. And so that Pharaoh gave him the ability to be able to do that, and he gave him the position to do that. And when Joseph got his opportunity, he didn't make excuses. He didn't start looking around for somebody else to do something. He says, I am the man for this time. It's time for me to step up and show them the God in me and what my God can do. Too many times when the spotlight comes, we shrink away and we've been running our mouth about what we would do if we got a chance. But when you get a chance, you mess up. Don't mess up when you get your chance. Rely on the God in you. Amen. Understand who you are and whose you are. And you step up and you tell those folks what God has planned for them. And you do that, and the scripture says the plan seemed good to Pharaoh and to all his officials. So Pharaoh asked, can we find anyone like this man, one in whom is the Spirit of God? Game recognizes game. Folks out in the world don't care how you can do what you do. They just want to know you can do what you do. And if it just so happens you're doing it because of the God in you, it's like, fine, do it. Because I'm trying to get paid. I'm trying to get my stuff covered. You want the promotion? You got it. Why did you get it? Because of the God in you? That's great. The God in you, great. Now take this job, take this position, do what you need to do. You give acknowledgement to God and let God enlarge your borders, amen? And so you have to perform. So the importance of performance by you, you look ahead, you plan ahead, and you move ahead, and that's exactly what Joseph did. And it went really well. 7 years of abundance in Egypt, verse 53, came to an end, and the 7 years of famine began, just as Joseph had said. There was famine in all the other lands, but in the whole land of Egypt, there was food. When all Egypt began to feel the famine, come on somebody, feel the famine, the people cried to Pharaoh for food. Then Pharaoh told all the Egyptians, go to Joseph and do what he tells you. And when the famine had spread over the whole country, Joseph opened the storehouses and sold grain to the Egyptians. And all the countries came to Egypt to buy grain from Joseph because the famine was severe in all the world. And so I don't think it was really a part of what they wanted to do or what Joseph had revealed in terms of we're going to have enough food, not just for Egypt, but we're going to have enough food to feed the world. Amen. That's how God blessed them in those 7 years, and them setting aside that 20%, that fifth, to be able to get through those lean years allowed them not only to have food for Egypt, but for beyond Egypt, which takes us to chapter 42. And when Jacob learned that there was grain in Egypt, and I don't know how you learn that there's grain in Egypt when you're hundreds of miles away and there is no social media and no telephones and no whatever else. But Jacob learned that there was grain in Egypt. And he said to his sons, why do you just keep looking at each other? I have heard that there's grain in Egypt. Go down there and buy some for us so that we may live and not die. What you doing looking around here? Go get some food. Then 10 of Joseph's brothers went down, but Jacob didn't send Benjamin. And it says, now Joseph was the governor of the land, the one who sold grain to all its people. So when Joseph's brothers arrived, they bowed down to him with their faces to the ground. As soon as Joseph saw his brothers, he recognized them. But he pretended to be a stranger and spoke harshly to them. Where do you come from? Now, if this was our story and not the story of Joseph in Genesis, this is right around the time when you see your brothers, you see them bow down, you're like, okay. You look over to the musicians, you say, shh. Play my song for me. And this is the song he would have played when he saw them. Hey! Got to pay back. Revenge. A man.
The big payback.
Got to get back. Need some get back.
Need some get back.
Yeah, cut it off. Yeah. That's the song he would have played. I know that's the song I would have played. You can pretend you would have played something else, but as soon as he saw it, he'd be like, oh, Rob, hit that for me. Hit the payback for me because we're getting ready to hit that. But if you want to live your best life, your very best life cannot include payback. Amen? Your very best life includes the importance of forbearance with others. Forbearance with others. And so Joseph didn't need to be seeking payback, he needed to be seeking penitence. He wasn't about revenge. He was about repentance. And in your very, very best life, you don't go around saying that I'm going to get back everybody that got me. I don't have time. I'm not going back and forth with you, brothers. I'm not doing that. Because I'm living my best life. And my best life means that I understand that sometimes things go sideways, but God's got me, and I'm not trying to put everything back on you. You have to go ahead and realize that you can't have everything be about vengeance. It can't be about payback. It's got to be about penitence. It can't be about revenge. It's got to be about repentance. The scripture says that God is not slack concerning his promise. He said, as some men count slackness, but is long suffering towards us, not willing that any should perish, but that all should come to repentance. That's in 2 Peter when it talks about the day. A day with the Lord is like 1,000 years, and 1,000 years is as a day. Because it's like, when is the day of the Lord going to come? And he said, just sit back and relax for a second. I have to help you to understand. I'm not slow. I'm not slack concerning the promise to bring the day of the Lord as you count slackness. But I want you to stand. I'm long-suffering. I'm patient, not willing that any should perish, but that all should come to repentance. And so I've stretched some things out because I want people to repent. The Lord says, I don't want to bang them. I want them to repent. And I want to give them time to do that. You and I have to have, if you want to live your best life, you cannot be consumed with the bitterness of what happened to you in your childhood and in the past and who did what to who. You got to let that stuff go. Or it will keep you from living your best life. And Joseph understood that. And he didn't play the big payback. Now, he messed with him a little bit. He did, gave him their money back and their sacks when they came to buy the grain, and then slipped the silver cup in one of the sacks, and you know, they play some back and forth things so that he could get his whole family. He wanted to see his little brother Benjamin, and they finally had to bring Benjamin with them and the whole thing, and that all was designed for him. And they didn't realize that he was Hebrew and not Egyptian, and so they were talking in their language, didn't realize he could understand. And when he could understand and hear that they were being penitent, they were like, you know why this is happening to us? It's because of what we did to Joseph. And that just broke his heart for them to connect that, you know, a lot of the trouble that we're having, it all really started when we came up with that terrible plan to get rid of Joseph. And Simeon was like, I told y'all. Now, it's always one. No, excuse me, it was Reuben. Didn't I tell you not to sin against the boy? But you wouldn't listen. Now we must give an accounting for his blood. They did not realize that Joseph could understand them since he was using an interpreter. That's in verse 22 or 42. So again, but he saw that they were penitent. He saw that they understood and connected, that they were sorrowful. And then eventually, by the time he gets to chapter 45, Joseph makes himself known. And Joseph says to his brothers, come close to me. And when they had done so, he said, I'm your brother Joseph, the one you sold into Egypt. And now, don't be distressed. Smile, bruh. Don't be distressed. Do not be angry with yourselves for selling me here, because it was to save lives that God sent me ahead of you. For 2 years now, there has been a famine in the land, and for the next 5 years, there will be plowing and weeping. But God sent me ahead of you to preserve for you a remnant on earth and to save your lives by a great deliverance. They hadn't seen him since he was 17, and he spent 13 years before he got to Pharaoh's service. So that's 30. 7 years of good and prosperous. He's 37. And then he said 2 years of famine. He's now 39. It's been 22 years. And he said, don't worry about it. He says, I need you to know that God sent me ahead of you. And so you have to understand the importance of forbearance with others. And finally, you have to understand, if you want to live your best life, the importance of guidance from God. The importance of guidance from God. And what do I mean by that? The proper recognition leads to the proper response that yields the proper result. Let me say that again. The proper recognition leads to the proper response, which leads to the proper result. Joseph recognized. Go ahead. Joseph recognized that it wasn't about his brothers or what they tried to do. It's always more important what God's trying to do. Amen. And he said, listen, I know what you did. What you meant for evil, God meant for good. And if I can have the proper recognition about God's purpose, then I can have the proper response for you, which is not elimination of your lives, but restoration of your lives. He said, that's why God sent me ahead of you to preserve you for a remnant on earth and to save your lives by a great deliverance. I could eliminate you. I could take all of you all out, but that's not what I'm on, because I've got the proper recognition that it's about what God wants to do, and that's more important than what you've done. With the proper recognition, beloved, you can have the proper response to your circumstances and situation, and you can get the proper result, which is restoration and not elimination. And that's the rest of the story. He did well in Egypt. They treated him to the best of the land. God brought them through and his whole family through for his own purposes, and he prospered them for his own purposes. And Joseph went from the pit to Potiphar's to prison to the palace. And he did it in such a way that Joseph was not only able to bring himself, but his entire family with him. He said, this is about saving many folks alive. And so if you want to live your best life, remember the importance of perseverance, the importance of reliance on God, the importance of performance by you, the importance of forbearance with other folks, and the importance of guidance from God. And if you do that, you will definitely be living your best life now.